Good morning and happy Easter. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. And that is the cry of Easter Sunday morning. I am Jim Morey, the pastor of Longwood Hills Congregational Church, and I would like to thank you for joining us for our Facebook Live worship celebration of Easter. Today, we wish all of you a very joyous Easter, and that you may experience the depth of God's love in this time of separation, that even though we cannot be together here in our sanctuary, we can be together in spirit. We can stay connected through this worship service, and we can celebrate our connection with one another in God, who has formed and fashioned each one of us and loves and treasures and cherishes each one of us. So this morning, as we celebrate Easter, we will all also celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion. And so if at this time you have not prepared, then I invite you to go and get some grape juice, or perhaps you would even have some wine. Gather together some bread so that we can celebrate the elements together and participate in the communion of the body and life of our Lord Jesus Christ that we celebrate this day. Now let us continue our worship as our music director Scott Kincaid leads us in singing.
Well, good morning and happy Easter. We're so glad that you joined us online this morning. Let's celebrate together as we sing Jesus Messiah. Please sing along. The words will be down below, or you can simply just listen and use this as a time of prayer this morning. He became sin who knew no sin, that we might become His righteousness. He humbled Himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah. Sinners, the ransom from heaven.
Happy Easter. This is Miss Sue, and we are going to attempt a children's message today. So gather the kids, and we're going to read a book, The Donkey That No One Could Ride by Antonio Di Stefano. There once was a donkey, young, weak, and small, so weak he could carry nothing at all. Even when children sat on his hide, he wobbled and tumbled and would fall on his side. No matter how much he tried or he cried, this was a donkey that no one could ride. He couldn't haul stones, he couldn't dig ditches or carry rich men with their big bag of riches. He couldn't pull a cart with a huge bale of hay. Just lifting a feather would make his legs sway. No, this donkey was useless, no good at all. Too punky, too shaky, too scrawny, too small. Now the owner was quite mean and tough. He said to the donkey, "I've had quite enough." He pointed his finger and said with a huff, "You can't lift a person, no matter how light. So take all your things and get out of my sight. So away from here, donkey, go away and just hide. What use is a donkey that no one can ride?" So the donkey was led to the far edge of town, pulled by his neck with his head hanging down. He was tied to a post on a small dusty road and left all alone while his tears overflowed. Left all alone and wondering why he was born to be weak and born to be shy and born to be frightened and born to cry. Just then, two men appeared alongside the post in the village where the donkey was tied. They came without warning on that fateful day. They came and untied him and took him away. The donkey was frightened. He said to the men, "Where are we going?" And then said again, "Where are we going? And what about me? Please leave me alone and just let me be." "Keep quiet," said the men. "We mean you no harm. Just follow us quickly. No cause for alarm." So they walked on for miles and miles until they took him to a town at the foot of a hill. At the foot of a hill stood a man tall and thin, wearing a cloak and a beard on his chin. He had eyes that seemed sad and longish brown hair and a voice soft and gentle that floated on air. He said to the donkey, "It's time that you knew about the great thing that you are destined to do. You'll carry me into the city, we two, into the city. I'll ride atop you." "What's that you say?" cried the donkey with dread. "There's simply no way. You've been misled. I'm just a small weakling. you must go ahead and look for another to take you instead. You see, I'm just hopeless. Ever since I was born, I've been subject to insults and teasing and scorn. My back's somewhat crooked. My legs aren't strong. I'm just a big failure who does everything wrong. Won't you believe me? The sad donkey cried. Just leave me alone and cast me aside. I'm just a poor donkey that no one can ride. The man looked at him with a face that was wise, with a warm, tender smile and a love in his eyes. And then, in a calm and mysterious way, he opened his mouth and started to say, "My help is enough. It's all that you need. It's all you require to live and to succeed. The weaker you are, the more strength I give. I'll be there to help you as long as you live. I know you feel tired and frightened and broken, but do you believe these words that I've spoken? Do you believe? I ask you again, do you have faith? I can heal you, my friend." For some reason, the donkey was sure he knew the words the man spoke were honest and true. They were said with such kind and caring love. It seemed they came from heaven above. The donkey burst out, "I believe that it's true. I believe," he repeated. "I believe, yes, I do." So the man stretched out his hand and covered or closed both his eyes. And then, to the little donkey's surprise, he felt a sensation he couldn't control from the top of his head right down to his soul. All of a sudden, he realized that now his body was stretching and changing somehow. Most amazing of all, at that very hour, the donkey began to sense he had power. He didn't feel small or weak any longer. Instead, he felt stronger and stronger and stronger. He could feel his body, the energy flowing. He could see with his eyes. His muscles were growing. His back felt like iron, his legs like steel. His chest felt so strong, it just couldn't be real. A miracle," the donkey cried out. A miracle beyond any doubt." In order to show all the thanks that he felt, the donkey bowed his head down and knelt in front of the man who had made him so strong, with a beard on his chin and his hair that was long. The man looked upon him with sorrowful eyes and then sat on his back and told him to rise. "We're bound for that city, that west of the hill. I have a great mission I need to fulfill." The donkey got up. His tears had dried. With big bulging muscles, he started to stride. No longer a donkey that no one could ride. Now he had courage and power and pride. He started to stride. He started to run. He couldn't believe he was having such fun. With a clippity-clop and a clippity-clop, he kept right on going with no need to stop. But as they drew near to the gate of the town, the donkey began to hear a very strange sound. The curious noise made him perk up his ears. And what could it be? It sounded like cheers. Soon, crowds of people came into sight, shouting and waving their arms with delight. They were cheering the man and giving him praise, yelling hosannas and crying hoorays. It was amazing to see the love they expressed. They called him a prophet and said he was blessed. In front of the donkey, they threw with their arms flowers and garments and branches and palms. They laid all of these down and started to sing, calling the man a savior and a king. The donkey was happy. Gone were the tears. Never had people sung in his ears. Never was there a moment so sweet as carrying a king with palms at his feet. And all his life after, the donkey rejoiced that the king had made such a wonderful choice to help with the greatest mission of all, the donkey used, the king used a donkey, young and weak and small. So every year at Easter time, renew your hopes again. Remember how a little faith can give you strength. And then gather all your friends around and tell the tale of when a tiny donkey carried God into Jerusalem. Well, happy Easter, everyone, and hope to see you soon. Everybody stay safe and healthy.
Christ the Lord is risen today. Alleluia. All creation join to say Alleluia. Raise your joys and triumphs high. Alleluia. Sing, O heavens and
hear the Easter story as it is recorded in the Gospel of John, chapter 20. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. And so she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they put him." Now, I'm going to skip forward a little bit, but after this, Peter and the other disciple ran to the tomb, and they discovered that it was empty. And then we are told that they went home, but Mary lingered there. Then the disciples went back to their homes, but Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not recognize him. "Woman," he said, "why are you crying? Who is it you're looking for?" Thinking he was a gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned around and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them I am returning to my Father and to your Father, to my God and to your God. Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, I have seen the Lord. And she told them that all that he had said to her. This is an incredible story, and one that stretches our imagination to believe. But certainly part of the story is not hard for us to believe. And that is that Mary, heavy in heart with grief, made the journey to the tomb. And as she walked along, we can imagine it was early in the morning, perhaps the sun had not come up yet. And so the darkness that surrounded her certainly was symbolic of that which she was feeling inside, the darkness of Good Friday that happened a few days before, and the cause of her great weeping. Because not only her Lord, and not only her teacher, but her dear friend had died a terrible death, suffering on a cross, being spit at and mocked by the crowd, crucified in the most horrendous of fashions, on display for everyone to see. And in the midst of this cheering crowd, she watched his life slowly ebb away from him. She cried because she felt the sorrow and the sadness of a broken heart. She was shattered. Her life fell apart and was in pieces. And it was not only her life that was in pieces because of the death of her Lord, but it was also her hope. The hope that she discovered in Jesus, in his words, in his teachings, in his healing. He had freed her from her enslavement to spirits, and he brought her from a life of darkness into a life of light and love, relationship, and love. And she was transformed by this. She's weeping because that vision, that hope, that relationship was taken away from her. And her life was shattered in pieces. That is why she is crying. Those are the words I imagine she could have spoken to the two angels and to Jesus had she had opportunity, or she had the capability of forming those words and expressing that deep sorrow. She would have explained the tears that come from the depths of her hurt and pain, of her life, hopes, and dreams being shattered. The reason I'm presenting this message today from this part of the sanctuary, and I realize there's a lot of white behind me, but I wanted to be over here because of this cross. And as you can see in this cross, it's misshaped and misformed. It is a collage of different colors and shapes, and it symbolizes the shatteredness that Mary felt and that we all feel in our lives. This past summer, we had a series of messages on being shattered. And we went through the various things in our lives where our life just simply falls apart in pieces and we feel shattered. It could be the loss of love. It could be the loss of a child through death. It could be a divorce. It could be the death of a spouse or parent or dear friend. It could be the loss of income, which many of us are going through right now because of this pandemic. We feel that loss. And we talked about how we are shattered, and we are all shattered in this life. None of us gets out of this life without being touched by tragedy, pain, or sorrow, suffering in some way. And that's our common denominator. I believe it was Scott Kincaid that came up with this idea to have a symbol and have shattered glass and allow people, invite people from the congregation to come forward and to make this mosaic, symbolizing the shatteredness of their lives as well as how we all share that together. Susan McMahon created the pieces. Tim Bartel formed this cross and cut it out. But our congregation was invited to come forward on a couple of different Sundays and take different pieces of glass, different shapes, and place them into this cross. And that symbolized that they too were shattered. They too had experienced that pain in their life, just like Mary on that Easter Sunday morning. They had been touched by sorrow and hurt. And so each piece represented their experience or experiences in their life, and they placed it into this cross. And then Sue McMahon applied some adhesive that filled the spaces between the broken glass. And when it hardened, it formed a solid piece that now we can hang it and none of them fall out, because that adhesive, that substance holds it together, holds all of our pain together, holds all of our brokenness together. And it's in the shape of a cross. And all of that symbolizes for our church and for us is that what we have in common as human beings is that we're all broken. We've all been shattered. We've all gone through experiences that hurt and sometimes cause us to fall to pieces. What we also have is the love of God. And that adhesive that holds these pieces together symbolizes the love of God that holds all of us together and provides healing and newness of life. And when we put it all together, when we allow God to love us in such a way and draw us together in that love, which is symbolic, symbolizes what happened on Good Friday, the cross. God so loved the world that he gave his son. God so loved the world, loved each one of us. And the incredible thing is that love that Jesus poured out through his life on the cross is a love that draws us all together and holds us together, just like this cross, just like Mary that first Easter morn. It is an affirmation that love is stronger than death. Yes, the religious leaders in Rome thought they did away with Jesus on Good Friday. They killed him on the cross. They laid him in the grave. They rolled the stone over it. And they went home thinking, that's it, it's over. But in the silence of that darkness, even God exists. And God's love swallowed up hatred. God's life swallowed up death. God's light surrounded the darkness and brought new life. And that's the new life that we experience today. It's the new life that will get us through this time of our separation because of this virus. It will join us together as a community, as churches, as a nation, and as a world, because this virus knows no boundaries of geography or language or culture or faith. It affects all of us. We all have it in common. And what we also have in common is that God has created each one of us in God's likeness and in God's image. We are all God-breathed, and we all are filled with God's holy breath. So death could not hold back God's love. And Paul, sometime later, expresses it this way: there is nothing in heaven and earth, in the future and the past, in the up or the down, there's nothing that can separate us from God's love. Nothing. And that's the truth that we take away from this story, that this tomb and the darkness and the death cannot separate us from God's love. New life reigns this day. And so today, as we celebrate communion, we are reminded that it is the new life that comes to us in this sacrament. And as we partake in it, we are reminded of a reality that's with us every day, and that far too often we forget. That on the night before he died, Jesus took bread, he blessed, he broke it, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In other words, remember, my love is stronger than anything. Nothing can separate you from my love. This is a reminder. Also, after supper, he took the cup, and having said the blessing, he gave it to his disciples and to all of us, saying, "Take and drink. This is my life. Nothing can separate you from my life. Whenever you drink of it, remember the truth that I love you. Nothing separates you from my love." So through the broken bread, we participate in the body of Christ. Through the cup of blessing, we participate in the new life which Christ brings. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for the gift of life and for your life that comes to us through the symbols of this bread and this juice. We thank you that through these symbols, you remind us always that nothing can separate us from your love. You remind us of the reality that we live and move and have our very being in you, in your love. And may this sacrament today feed us spiritually, remind us of that reality, that we can face the challenges, yes, of this time and our time of separation and our time of crisis and challenge as a community and people and nation and world, and that your love will see us through. We pray for those who have died from this virus. We pray for their grieving families. We pray for those who are ill presently with it. We pray for their healing and their new life. We pray for our doctors and our nurses, our EMTs, and our firemen and our police officers as they respond to people's needs. We pray this, lifting to you, knowing that you are the God of life and you will see all of us through this to a new day. And this we pray in Jesus' name as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Take and eat the life of Christ for you. Do this in remembrance of him. Take and drink the life of Christ for you. Do this in remembrance of his love for you, from which you can never be separated. And now may this, the life of Christ, keep you, hold you, sustain you, and empower you to life everlasting, that it may be according to your faith, that God's love, grace, peace, and spirit may abide with you this day. Amen. Once again, I want to thank you for joining us on this Easter Sunday morning for our worship service and the celebration of the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And to be reminded that God can pick up the pieces of our lives. God can pick up the pieces of our churches. God can pick up the pieces of our communities, the pieces that are broken because of this virus and the separation of relationship, the distance we feel with one another, the loss of jobs or income. God can pick up the pieces, and God's love will hold us together. And now may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May God's favor be upon you and give you peace this day and forever. Happy Easter. Amen. Not to us, but to your